Everyone is crying out for peace, yes. None is crying out for justice. Everyone is crying out for peace, yes. None is crying out for justice.
Welcome to the first in our summer series of engagements on critical areas of culture, critical areas of history, of politics, and the role of the university. Friends and colleagues, these are indeed some serious times. All I can see around us is just violence and crime. But I will sing redemption song instead, because it is definitely time for redemption. I want to begin, therefore, with the words of Marcus Garvey: liberate the minds of men, and ultimately you will liberate the bodies of men. As an ethical university with an activist mandate, we come to you today to share with great humility as persons who live lives of service through education. We have been paying attention to the comments, the discomfort, the systemic oppression, the dis-ease that many feel at different times in different ways, feeling like second-class citizens or persons living in a country which has truly not understood the term independence. Of course, we live in a global world where we exist as part of the commonwealth, or as I like to say, the common poor. We live in a world where we are part of the African diaspora, the Americas. Indeed, we live in a global world, but within sneezing distance of the United States of America, where matters of citizenship and questions around nationhood rear their heads frequently. The assassination of George Floyd was a pivotal moment for us all as global citizens, and the resurgence of the Black Lives Matter movement became a clarion call for all of us to look at our lives, our Black lives, post-colonial lives, independent lives. But here in Jamaica, there are so many unresolved questions of nationhood. Indeed, the task of emancipation is yet incomplete, and I can hear Erna Broadbent's words echoing this. So today we bring you a critical engagement of symbols of Jamaican nationhood. Importantly, I begin with gratitude. This event is a partnership, and I want to sincerely thank the National Council on Reparation, the Center for Reparations Research, for being always supportive, and for both engaging with the Institute of Caribbean Studies on this event. I want to thank them for their continued support in maintaining attention around key issues in relation to daily life in this our post-colonial world. I want to also thank the team at the ICS for rising to the call of duty every time. Most of all, I want to thank the coordinator, Dr. Jelani Nayo, and all the speakers. I want to thank them for their time. I want to thank Isabel Dennis, Kaylian Williams, and Bettine Ross-Laws. I am Dr. Sonia Stanley Nayo, and I am your moderator for this afternoon's session. Let me introduce to you our very first speaker, Professor Vereen Shepherd, who is director of the Center for Reparations Research at the UWI's regional headquarters. The title of our presentation this afternoon, More Than Statues, Colonial Relics in Contemporary Jamaica. Vereen is the current host of Talking History on Nationwide 90 FM and a social historian, as well as vice chair of the United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. She is a past university rector of the Institute for Gender and Development Studies at the University of the West Indies, and she has spent 5 years as a member of the UN's Working Group of Experts on People of African Descent. As a published author, she has written several books, among them, I Want to Disturb My Neighbor, Lectures on Slavery, Emancipation, and Postcolonial Jamaica in 2007, Livestock, Sugar, and Slavery, Contested Terrain in Colonial Jamaica in 2009, and Maharani's Misery, Narratives of a Passage from India to the Caribbean in 2002. Her awards, several awards, include the Government of Jamaica's Order of Distinction in the Commander class for outstanding service to education in history and gender studies, among other awards. We are pleased, therefore, to welcome Vereen to this webinar and want to hear her give her remarks. Over to you, Vereen.
Thank you, Chair, and greetings to fellow panelists and our online audience. I am honored that the Center for Reparation Research, located at the University of the West Indies, is one of the collaborating entities for this forum, and congratulate the ICS and the members of the Internal Reparation Working Group of the National Council on Reparation, chaired by Dr. Jelani Nayar, for enabling this important conversation. But permit me also, Chair, to pay my respects to my Cameroonian ancestors on my mother's side and to the only known enslaved African ancestor, Alexander Mighty, my great-great-grandfather, born in 1829 and fully free in 1838. I apologize to all the ancestors who were enslaved in Jamaica for my inability to convince my own government that to keep statues of Queen Victoria, Christopher Columbus, and Governor Metcalfe standing on our landscape, along with the persistence of other colonial relics, is an insult to you who work so hard for our collective freedom. Now, on July 8th, the United Nations Department of Global Communications hosted a webinar on the theme of museums, memorials, and memorialization after atrocity, communicating a form of ongoing justice. Among the questions asked, whether directly or indirectly, were the following. What role can monuments, statues, and memorials play after atrocities or crimes in furthering the interests of justice? How do the monuments, statues, and memorials help us to live in the present? What kinds of futures are we creating for surviving victims and/or descendants of dead victims by the monuments, statues, and memorials that we have erected on the landscape and/or placed in museums, communities, and educational institutions? And finally, where does history sit at this crossroads of monuments, memorials, and memorialization after atrocity or atrocities? In the time allowed me for this presentation, I will try to address questions 3 and 4, although I may touch tangentially on the others. To contextualize the presentation though, let me say that in the wake of the murder of George Floyd in the United States of America, the world watched as the Black Lives Matter campaign intensified and became global and coalesced around the issue of justice for Africans and people of African descent. A key focus of the campaign was the removal of statues and monuments on the landscape that honored colonialists, especially those connected with slavery, Jim Crow, and pro-colonialist regimes, and whose iconic placement insulted those living with the legacies of the African Holocaust. While the USA paid attention to Columbus and Confederate monuments, the UK to Dundas, Colston, Milligan, and Rhodes, Belgium to Leopold II, South Africa to Gandhi and Rhodes, in the Caribbean, the focus was mainly on Columbus, Queen Victoria, Rodney, Lord Nelson, and colonial governors like Metcalfe. But the iconographic decolonization conversation must extend beyond the toppling of statues and memorials to colonial icons on our landscape and include other colonial relics. We are all familiar now with Clyde Williams' activism around the insignia worn by the Governor General of Jamaica and in a modified style by the British High Commissioner to Jamaica. In an interview with the host of CVM Live on June 29, the High Commissioner, His Excellency Asif Ahmad, elaborated, and I quote, "I was checking with my colleague, who is also a member of the Order of St. Michael and St. George in Barbados, and she said hers is actually white, both on the angel as well as Satan. I have checked mine very closely, and mine is a slightly Middle Eastern looking angel and a darker devil, end of quote. So there are different templates depending on the ethnicity of the wearer. I find that troubling. Several of us have also called for the renaming of the Musgrave Medals as it is unseemly for an independent country to hold on to such a colonial relic. For those unaware, each year, the Institute of Jamaica awards Musgrave Medals to persons considered by its council as worthy recipients in the gold, silver, and bronze categories in the fields of literature, art, and science. The existence of this award, named in honor of the Institute's founder, Sir Anthony Musgrave, a governor of Jamaica from August 23, 1887 to April 20, 1883, has never been embraced by all. Even though the award has been in existence in one form or another since 1897, with annual awards since 1889, there are mixed views on the appropriateness of continuing to name such a prestigious award after a colonial governor, one who represented the British monarchy during the years of Crown Colony government, when there was no local representation in government in the island, thereby continuing the undemocratic practices of government that characterized the slavery era. The only recipient I know of, there you may know of other people, who questions its legitimacy even while accepting the award was the late Camor Brathwaite, who among other criticisms said that the award should rock us into birth and not bury us in history, that the concept of gold, silver, and bronze is not conducive to art, and that the colors should be indigenized, changed to black, red, and gold, a mix of Jamaica national and Garvey colors. In 2007, there was also vocal opposition from some members of the Jamaica National Bicentenary Committee when the Institute of Jamaica decided to dedicate the 2007 award to the bicentennial. Some members opted not to be involved on the grounds that they did not wish to be associated with an award named after a colonial governor, especially in a year in which the country was recalling the atrocities of British colonialism, whether under terrorist or benevolent governors. Musgrave might not have been a governor heir, but while his regime might have been considered progressive in some quarters, by the standards of the time, he also implemented policies that expose his racist and classist biases, cropping of women's hair in prison as punishment, flogging and hanging, although he was at pains to assure the colonial office that hanging in Jamaica was not carried out by the long drop, as if that made any difference to the victim. And opposition to compulsory elementary education, partly on the basis that the suggestion of half-time release from plantation labor to school children working on estate would be opposed by the proprietors. In his view also, compulsory education was far too much advanced treatment for the lower strata of a population, which 50 years ago had not emerged from a debasing state of slavery in which any education at all was forbidden, as he said. The question still remains, does the regime of Governor Sir Anthony Musgrave justify his association with a prestigious Jamaican Heritage Award in the post-colonial period when progressive Jamaicans are calling for the completion of the process of iconographic decolonization, a more liberating narrative of self, and the inscribing on the landscape of more indigenous icons? And by the way, we give Governor Musgrave a free pass while denigrating Lady Musgrave. Have we ever thought about the contradictions of the alleged request by his wife to build a road for her so that she could bypass Devon House and his alleged accession to that request? Discussions in Jamaica have also turned to the renaming of roads, highways, buildings, institutions, and communities like Lady Musgrave Road, the Queen's Warehouse at the airport, Jubilee Hospital, the Queen's School, Monroe College, named after enslaver Robert Monroe, Columbus Prep, Discovery Bay, Sanders Royal Plantation houses like Rose Hall and Hals Hall, and Brownstown, a community named after the Irishman Hamilton Brown. Hamilton Brown was a high-ranking member of the militia who played a role in suppressing the liberation efforts of the enslaved, including in the 1831-32 Emancipation War led by Samuel Sharp. As a member of the Colonial Church Union, Brown, who objected to emancipation, participated in the burning of Baptist churches and free villages of the newly freed because many of the rebels were aligned to the native Baptists, who played, in his view, a presumptuous role in making the enslaved believe they were human beings deserving of freedom. At emancipation, Brown filed 24 claims for compensation for 1,029 enslaved Africans. He received £22,179 sterling, or £19.7 million at 2019 estimate, on Haddon, Bridgewater, Rose Hill, Minard, Egypt, Culloden, Fullerton Park, Devon, Antrim, Mount Helicon, Colliston, Content, Colchis, and Nightingale Grove. Comparatively little attention has been given to the veneration of planters within and outside of the walls of Anglican churches and burial sites. In schools founded by planters and staffed in the early years by headmasters who were enslavers, and in the corners of our minds based on a colonial education. In this regard, I call on churches such as the Spanish Town Cathedral in St. Catherine, the Church of St. John the Evangelist in Black River, St. Elizabeth, that stands like a counterpoint to the Zong monument erected nearby, and the Anglican Church in Savalinamar, Westmoreland, to teach their congregations the true history of William Beckford, James Monroe, Caleb Dickinson, Peter Beckford, Duncan Robertson, and Thomas Thistlewood, respectively. Plus many more, there are many others. Many Jamaican schools founded with money from enslavers also need to rewrite their school's history and erect memorials to those whose labor contributed to the enrichment of their benefactors. If you have included these enslavers in your Hall of Fame, remove them. And if, like the UWI, your school is on a former plantation, follow the example of the University of the West Indies and erect a monument with the names of the enslaved who lived on that property as a mark of respect and gratitude. So where does history sit at this crossroads of monuments, memorials, and memorialization after the atrocity of African enslavement? Part of the answer lies in Elsa Gabaya's reminder to us in 1959 that our history is not dead knowledge. Its significance for us is vital and immediate. That in a country such as Jamaica, where shame about the past too often fills the place that should be held by knowledge, knowledge of the past must play its part in our liberation from the bonds of the past. Revisionist history education has to be used as a tool for the liberation of the mind from the bonds of the past, especially if infused with the hard facts of Europe's economic underdevelopment of the Caribbean by Eric Williams, the philosophies and opinions of Marcus Garvey, the gendered historical research of Lucille Mathurin Mear, the rehabilitative ideas of Frantz Fanon and Aimé Césaire, the work on Haiti of C.L.R. James, and the revolutionary precepts of Walter Rodney. I think that some post-colonial historians of the Caribbean, many trained at the University of the West Indies' history departments, have embraced their responsibility to write, W-R-I-T-E, in order to write, R-I-G-H-T, the myths and celebrated narratives of the past. Eric Williams and others have shown us that the Caribbean was the site of the formation of European ideas of modernity and their construction of notions of hegemony. And all of us who live in Caribbean space have been deeply offended by the actualization of such notions of hegemony and feel the need to write against it constantly. Many historians engage in applied history and have become scholar activists embracing the philosophy that history prepares us for activism, that history is a way of ordering knowledge, which then becomes an active part of the consciousness of the mass of ordinary people and can be used by all as an instrument of social change. Walter Rodney himself transformed himself, we are told, from a guerrilla intellectual to, in his words, a revolutionary intellectual, because, as he said, to be a revolutionary intellectual helps to provide a point of reference to the struggle of the Black liberation movement. In his paper, The Role of the Historian in the Developing West Indies, we call it Caribbean now, Rodney argued persuasively that, and I quote, "It is one of the tasks of the historian of the West Indies to approach the society in a different manner and to lay emphasis on precisely what was going on in the region. This would certainly lead to the presentation of new heroes with whom the West Indian people could identify, an important psychological necessity," end of quote. Finding such new heroes and heroines involves excavating our history of agency from deep layers of distortion, giving revolutionaries iconic status, and projecting them on the landscape in order to have alternatives to the colonial icons that are proving so hard to dislodge. The field of resistance studies has in fact blossomed and thrown up new icons. We have evidence to show that colonial oppressors we have elevated to iconic status only stayed in power because of their weaponization of the Caribbean. Even so, they eventually had to relent in the wake of the persistent wars of resistance, which so economically affected the plantation economy that it became unsustainable. Some of these revolutionaries have been placed on our landscape as a counter discourse to the colonial narrative that presented them as criminals and violent protesters who upset the so-called peace and stability of plantation societies. Many died in the process, and they are all worthy of collective respect and memorialization, even though our tendency is to focus on leaders. To conclude, in her book, Pointing to the Dead, Victims, Martyrs, and Public Memory in South Africa, Sabine Marshall states, and I quote, "A memorial constitutes a transitional object that facilitates the process of mourning. Public commemoration, especially through lasting memorials of selected dead heroes, can be a strategic move to legitimate the emergence of a new socio-political order." Elsa Gavaya puts it this way, and I quote, "There is much to be learned from the experiences of those who took part in these struggles for reform, who centered what ought to have been seen as universal tenets of liberty and equality. And among them were Sally Bassett of Bermuda, Nan of the Jamaican Maroons, Juan Tete Loque of St. Martin, Sam Sharp of Jamaica, Busa and Nanny Grieg of Barbados, Dessalines and Toussaint and Bootman Dutty of Haiti, and so many more whose history deserves to be known, the new icons for our memorialization." Thank you, Chair.
Thank you so much, Vireen. Your presentation gives, I'm sure for many listening, a new definition to applied history, to activist history. Thank you so much for those reflections.
Thank you very, very much, Vireen. I think in some ways we forget that there are those persons, our ancestors, our freedom fighters, who we need to privilege in our conversations moving forward in the progress towards independence and certainly building new nations of people fighting for freedom. Thank you so much for those words. I want to now introduce Professor Clinton Hutton, who is one of my dear friends, one of the longest colleagues I have been associated with at the University of the West Indies. Professor Hutton is going to speak to us on signs and symbols of the past and the present, a 21st century challenge to the epistemology, ontology, and culture of white supremacy. He holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in Mass Communication with Social Sciences and the Doctor of Philosophy in Political Science from the UWI. He also holds a certificate in teaching education from the Michael University College. And he joined the staff of the Mona campus in 1994, an internationally recognized scholar, public intellectual, educator, photographer, and painter. I'm pleased to introduce to you Professor Clinton Hutton.
Thank you. Greetings, everyone. I think that one of the things that we need to understand is that signs and symbols of colonialism that we still have on our landscape, on our mindscape today, are signs of power, power then and power now. Power then and power now. There are signs of a kind of identity that suppressed our forebears for hundreds of years. Jamaica, as for example, this year Jamaica would have 528 years, but up to independence, Jamaica experienced 468 years of colonialism. Of those 468 years, that is up to 1962, 329 of those years were years of enslavement. This year will be 60 years since independence. Certainly, one of the primary goals of independence is rooted in the concept of decolonization. We can't develop based on the identity, the culture that enslaved our people, that colonized our people, that committed genocide against native people, making them obscure and invisible. We cannot build a future on that type of culture. We cannot build a future on that way of thinking and creating knowledge, that kind of epistemology. We cannot build a future of that type on the basis of the type of identity that that culture created. It has created an identity which assumed and asserted that Black people are subordinate human beings, that they are intellectually inferior, that they are inherently ugly, and so on. We cannot build our future on that. One slaveholder, a Caribbean planter, actually says, and it's very important to note this, policy and safety required that we crush the race of Blacks by a contempt so great that whoever descends from it, even to the sixth generation, shall be covered with an indelible stain. The purpose of colonialism was to so stain the identity, the thought processes of those who were colonized, that they themselves, the colonized, would perpetuate slavery on their own up until the sixth generation. That's very important to note. It's very important to note that this person making this statement, as were the thousands and millions of other statements, were very conscious as to what they were doing. They were conscious that they need to create ideas and rituals that will put Black people in their place and for them to stay in their place as subordinates. The purpose of independence is to negate all of that. And therefore, signs and symbols that continue the perpetuation of ideas like that of this planter, we have to do everything. Whatever language and however diplomatic that language is today, and it can be very diplomatic in the 21st century, we have to exercise that language, diplomatic or otherwise, in order to create a new interpretation of our space, of our history, of our futures. We have to do that. When Jamaica became an independent nation, one of the things that we did was to abolish Emancipation Day. Emancipation Day was abolished, and to borrow the motto from the United States, out of many one people. It is out of many one people that thousands of Americans were lynched. It is out of many one people that George Floyd was murdered in a sacrificial ceremony. It is out of that type of situation in which the rabid inequality that we have seen, not just in the United States, but amongst wherever Black people live, that type of inequality, that type of injustice that we have seen, it is in the case of Jamaica under the notion of out of many one people, similarly in the United States. So it is not, sometimes it is not the symbol or the words denoted by symbols that we should look at, but practice. It's important to look at practice. Now, there are other things. So that Louise Bennett, that voice, whenever I hear that voice, I feel a special relationship with myself and my people. But that voice of the Jamaican language is unofficial still. We are unofficial in the color of our skin. Anything too Black, no good. We are unofficial in the texture of our hair, bad head. We are unofficial in the way we speak, chat bad. The purpose of a nation is to unite its people on the basis of the long, long, long history of struggle against colonialism. From the first day the Europeans came here, there have been resistance to that. There has been resistance to that type of colonial occupation. Wherever there was slavery, there was anti-slavery. And so, for example, in 1760, with the first national uprising, the first Pan-African uprising in Jamaica, led by Tacky. One of the leaders of that uprising was arrested, tried, and executed by being burnt. This is how one of the planters described how this man who assaulted slavery, how he met his demise, how he performed his death. The observer says, the wretch that was burnt was made to sit on the ground, and his body being chained to an iron stake, the fire was applied to his feet. He uttered not a groan. and saw his legs reduced to ashes with the utmost firmness and composure. After which, one of his arms, by some means getting loose, he snatched a brand from the fire that was consuming him and flung it at the face of his executioner. Why is this important? Jamaica's future and the future of people who were colonized and enslaved cannot be assured, cannot be placed on a good footing if we do not take with us on this journey of decolonization our ancestors, like the one who performed his debt against the dystopian order that Europeans imposed upon the people. It is this type of education that our young people, whenever I teach, I always get the same thing. Sir, how come we never hear about them something else? We have to teach another way. The philosophy of resistance, the philosophy of pride, the philosophy of personhood, the symbols of pride, the colors of pride and resistance of our forbearers. We have to walk hand in hand with these in our struggle for a better future, for a decolonized future. We, whether we are in Jamaica or the rest of the Caribbean or United States or Africa, we cannot proceed without our ancestors. And what has happened after independence is that quite often our independent government vilify, proscribe the systems developed by our forebears, the spiritual systems in which ancestors were number one, the spiritual systems of voodoo, of Mayan, of revival, the spiritual system of Rastafari, the spiritual system of comfort and of Lukumi, of Shango, of spiritual Baptists. We often, the people who are adherents to these institutions that form the cultural basis of the faith of our resistance, very often our governments that have taken over from the colonial government seem to want to be prejudicial against those institutions. We have to stop that. We have to find a different way. And the different way is rooted in what we can learn from what our forebears did to resist and to develop a culture, an anti-colonial culture, an anti-colonial culture which at the beginning of our recorded music industry, our musicians took up and made thematically central to the journey of Jamaican popular music. And so, for example, it was not long after independence that you have a song by Eric Montemorris, "If life was a thing that money could buy, the rich would live and the poor would die." It was not long after that that you have the Wailers singing, "Today they say we are free, only to be chained to poverty." The philosophers in our music industry got it. They got it philosophically. They got it culturally. And quite often, it's our political class that lags behind. I won't speak to the issue of signs in terms of naming places. Maureen spoke to that. Spaces, statues. But the fact of the matter is, we can't allow, I'm not by any means suggesting that those statues should be destroyed at all. I would be very much opposed to that. We have a lot of lessons to learn from that. As they are today, and where they are today, I think it's always been offensive to me. More people are now saying it's offensive to them as well. And instead, we must honor our forebearers in renaming places. James McLaren, 23 years old, the youngest leader of the Morant Bay Uprising, the secretary to Paul Bogle, argued in 1865 that people should get land without compensation because they earned it. He argued that. He was executed. He argued that he was still a slave, although he was not born in slavery. He was still a slave because he could not support his family. That's what he said. In other words, what he was pointing to was the poverty, the imposed poverty, the 11 generations of imposed poverty on African peoples in this country. And then Marley, the Whalers, spoke to the same thing just a few years after independence. Today they say we are free only to be chained to poverty. And I know that there are many people in this country who said to get over it. They apparently have not gotten over it because they are here defending colonialism. We should not allow it to pass. We should not allow it to pass. This country cannot be better. Its economy cannot be stronger if we pursue the same policy of Governor Eyre and the governors after emancipation. Because what they did, and the examples are there in various forms to be seen, what they did was to do everything to marginalize, to obscure blackness from participating as owners in the economy. They were very clear that black people should be laborers in the economy. In the United States, when the military leader went to announce in Texas in 1865 that the people are now free from slavery, and he read a statement. In that statement that he read to announce that the people are free, they went back on their promise of 40 acres and a mule by saying that the people should, they are now free, they are no longer slaves, but they should do their duty as laborers, so that the American emancipation after the promise of compensation reverted to what the colonialists did in Jamaica and executed Bogle for. The economy of Jamaica, for it to be bigger, requires that you include at the level of owners with training, proper training. An institution should reorganize themselves to this end. to include those who have been excluded during colonialism, and largely so after colonialism. We should not allow those things to stand. And it is this, within this context that I look and I did this presentation, that there's always lessons to be learned. We need to be more imaginative. I think one thing that they got right, the color of the Jamaican flag. And I'm not saying that those who have become the leaders after independence, that they did nothing right. But Jamaican independence allowed the brown middle class to come to power. That's what independence was. And therefore the philosophy of independence was rooted on that. And still to a large extent so. But the Jamaican flag was the same color of the rosettes worn by the supporters of Leonard Percival Owell when he went into the courthouse in the early 1930s to defend himself and to declare that His Imperial Majesty is the Almighty God, and that the people should not listen or take as their leader the King of England. His supporters wore green, black, and yellow rosettes. The color of Bogle's flag was red, black, and white. The color of Garvey's flag was red, black, and green. And then you have the all-nation flags of revival. So that there are many things that we should learn. And it is for our poets, our artists, our singers. It is for us to use our creative imagination to chart a path rooted in the resistance culture of our people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much, Professor Hutton. How do we leave our ancestors behind or out of our daily lives? Indeed, we were taught to leave them behind, but we have to right that wrong and move forward with our ancestors leading from the front. So thank you very much for that poignant reminder. I want to welcome those joining us now live on Facebook and those who have recently joined via Zoom. We bring you this critical engagement on the symbols of Jamaican nationhood from the Institute of Caribbean Studies in partnership with the Center for Reparation Research and the National Council on Reparation. I want to now introduce Dr. Shani Roper, our next speaker. She's the curator at the UWI Museum, the UWI regional headquarters. She is a former research officer and acting director of Liberty Hall, the legacy of Marcus Garvey. Dr. Roper believes that museums are community spaces in which visitors are encouraged to explore, be empowered, and unpack complex narratives. She is trained as a social historian, and her research interests include histories of Caribbean childhood, museums education, among others. And of course, she has published numerous articles in journals such as Jamaica Journal, Caribbean Studies, as well as the Journal of the History of Childhood and Youth. Her topic today is the Order of National Hero, a failed sociocultural experiment. Dr. Roper.
That come out of the celebration in October 13, 1965. Mr. Sangster, then the PM, acting PM, on his reflection, wished that the lesson to be learned was that the same objectives in these days, which is freedom and equality, can be achieved by peaceful constitutional means. And this is in response to honoring Paul Bogle and George William Gordon. The Honorable Lyndon Newland, MP of the constituency, stressed that the National Heroes focuses attention of the present generation on the noble deeds of the past. And Mr. Newland, another commentator, celebrated the determination of the government to pay tribute to those who have contributed in the past, sometimes at the cost of their lives, towards independence. And he goes further to argue that he doesn't wish for quarters in the population to believe that they are celebrating revolution, but we feel it's important to acknowledge revolution in our past. And lastly, the Honorable Edward Siaga, under whose portfolio the as Minister of Development and Welfare, who had responsibility for the National Honor Scheme, as well as the formation of JCDC and the repatriation of Marcus Garvey's body, stressed that focusing attention on the country's past, upon its great achievements, and on its great men, and only one woman, so that people today could understand that Jamaicans had to a large extent been responsible for their country's achievements. The Order of National Hero, therefore, is constructed in this specific manner. The fight against oppression since the invasion of Christopher Columbus have all culminated in the granting of independence. And it places independence at the pinnacle of achievement and masks the radical leanings of national heroes like Nanny of Maroons, Samuel Sharp, Paul Bogle, George William Garden, and Marcus Garvey. Now, scholars have extensively argued about the construction of the Jamaican state and its relationship with cultural identity, and more specifically, its struggle with Black radicalism. And so for this focus, I'm really going to just mention four scholars, Louis Lindsay, Rex Nettleford, three scholars, and Maziki Tame. And Louis Lindsay's Myth of Independence, he argues that independence is a myth, i.e. because constitutional independence does not equal economic independence, and that symbols are important to manipulate the population to accept and legitimize the new status quo. Rex Nettleford argues that the construction of national identity privileges some types of Blackness over others, more specifically, the elevation of a romanticized view of the Black Jamaican peasant experience over the Black radical experience. And I want to just kind of stop here to say where we see this happening the most. In when people do their celebration of emancipation and independence, the objects that people put out on the table are the kitchen bitch, the porcelain chimney, and several others of that genre. And I'm not saying that that's not an important part of Jamaican identity, but it is not the only element in Jamaican Black identity, but it's somehow the most celebrated. And this, so Rex Nettleford says that by the privileging of this view, it helps to create this ambiguity around Blackness, Africanness, and its relationship to being Jamaican. And this is taken further by Deborah Thomas. And lastly, Maziki Tame, which her 2017 article argues that a significant amount of the ambivalence around race has to do with who is doing the construction of national identity. And so the promotion, as she terms it, of brown nationalism, which Prof. Hutton has just referred to, brown nationalism being the political project that promotes Jamaica as a mixed, hybrid/brown, civilized, Anglophile space that distances its development from Blackness and more specifically Black radical thought. And so, and she says that this is subsumed under the motto, out of many, one people, that also emerges out of the tercentenary celebrations of 1955. Which celebrated 300 years. So, which is within this context, in my own kind of reflecting around the issues of the Order of National Hero, I see it almost as at the independence moment as potentially tokenism, meaning that it's a cultural tool to mobilize consensus on a place of Blackness in cultural identity that is about elevation of political figures and their role in developing a nation state, as opposed to dealing with the psycho, social and political agendas that each movement espoused. And so if people, and I noticed that quite a few people feel like there's not an issue about racism in Jamaica, but there is a high level of anti-Blackness in how Jamaican society functions. And I think that the easiest one for us to identify is the issue around hair, more specifically the hair of children at the early childhood level and the policing of styles like locks and their appropriateness for school. So now that we've had constitutional independence for 58 years, the pinnacle of Jamaican society isn't actually the attainment of independence, but what will ground Jamaica for tomorrow. And if we are taking our national heroes as indicators of national values, are we saying that we are a nation that's committed to social justice, a nation committed to the democratization of knowledge, a nation committed to the promotion of African spirituality? Are we committed to a livable wage and to those things that are important to create equity among all people? I would like to say that if we're using our national heroes, then they can't be solely about our journey to independence. And it requires a re-engagement. And I'm going to posit two because I have to wrap up. But the two that I suggest is a re-examination of our celebration of our national heroes. So if on the birthday of national heroes, you can go to National Heroes Park and you can listen to the band play a very British song. I can't remember what it's called. And you won't have an alternate experience of these heroes. It's almost a recreation of Empire Day in the approach to celebrating nationhood. And for those who don't know, Empire Day was the day when children got flags, when Empire heroes were celebrated, where you got sweetie and drinks. And if you speak to people from that generation, they can tell you who the British heroes are. A lot of these people can't tell the difference between the heroes of independence. And so we have to move away from this. And so it can't be only through the establishment of committees that we identify who or what the meanings of our heroes is or going to be. It has to be that we have to move the discussion away from National Heroes Park and into other spaces. And one of the best way to do this is to mobilize the intersection of art and representation with history. So we need more cartoons or comics or a kind of, I don't even know the term that I want to use, but it can't be that we're doing politicians. We can't be that we're doing the people. We have to take the leaders. We have to take, for example, the woman who was shot in her stomach at Frome. That a story needs to be created about that woman. And the women and other persons who participated in these wars that Prof. Shepherd and Prof. Clinton speak about and that they show out in their programs should now be taken to the next stage with art, with murals, and with persons in those areas to participate. So the tool really is the democratization of the discussion and the use of art to expand our discussion. Well, thank you very much. And I look forward to any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much, Dr. Roper. Are we a nation committed to equitable citizenship or tokenism? That's the question I've taken away from your presentation. I want to thank you so much for those well thought through engagements. I'm also wanting to remind our audience that we're paying attention to comments in the chat. We are paying attention to your comments, your questions. We're noting the emphasis on the teaching of history, the teaching of civics, going back to the days when we were teaching civics in school. You can pose your questions in the chat and we will certainly ask our speakers to respond to burning questions. But let me introduce you to our next speaker, Mr. Clyde Williams. Clyde is an attorney at law. He is one who practices as an advocate, barrister, and also a citizen activist. He was called to the bar in 1996. And those of you who are on social media can certainly remember that Clyde is a spirited engager in terms of social media and certainly Twitter, where I follow him. Clyde is going to speak to us today about the topic King's House, a symbol of white supremacy. Over to you, Clyde.
So the presentation is about King's House, the symbol of white supremacy. And I'm going to be referring to several documents as we go along. The first document is really just a picture of King's House. And then just beneath it, we have the order in council that gave birth to the Jamaican state. So in the Constitution of Jamaica did not come, as we know, by an act of the Jamaicans. It was not an act of Jamaica that made our constitution. It was an act of the British monarch at Buckingham Palace on the 23rd of July, 1962. Now, our constitution came as a schedule to the order from the British crown. Now, in that constitution, it places the queen as the head of the legislature and the head of the executive. In fact, it reads, in relation to the parliament, there shall be a parliament of Jamaica, which shall consist of Her Majesty, a Senate, and a House of Representatives. So that's the parliament. And then it goes further in the constitution to speak about the executive authority of the country. The executive authority of Jamaica is vested in Her Majesty. So let me pause here just to make one very critical point. The focus on Her Majesty is a constitutional fiction because Her Majesty plays no practical role in the legislative operations of the country. She plays no practical role in the formation of policy or programs of the government of Jamaica. So though she is the repository of the executive authority of Jamaica, it is a symbolic repository of the authority of the executive. And it is also symbolic that she is the head of our parliament. Further, her presence in Jamaica is carried out by the Governor General. Now, the Governor General does not serve Jamaicans. It might sound very odd to say this. The Governor General's first task is to represent Her Majesty. Article 27 of the Constitution, there shall be a Governor General of Jamaica who shall be appointed by Her Majesty and shall hold office during Her Majesty's pleasure, and who shall be Her Majesty's representative in Jamaica. So the office of the Governor General represents the British monarch. It doesn't represent Jamaicans. It's not the embodiment of nationhood. It's not the embodiment of the culture of our people. It represents the former enslaver. Now, this former enslaver, the British monarch, has been unapologetic about slavery. 329 years of enslavement, and they have been unapologetic. In fact, a prime minister recently came here and said, we must move on. So as a consequence of that, I can only see the office of the Governor General, King's House, as the seat of the monarch, as the symbol of white supremacy here in Jamaica. The Governor General does not play any specific function in the country in relation to the production of policy and our laws. He has three main areas that he concerns himself about. That's the office of the Governor General. One is pretty formal. He acts on the advice of the Prime Minister. The other, and advice of other bodies in the Constitution, the other role he plays is an intermediary role. And you will, in the news is now, is about the DPP and whether there should be an extension of 3 years and so on. He plays an intermediary role in that specific instance. The Prime Minister advises him, having discussed with the leader of the opposition what he intends to do. The Governor General relates that information to the leader of the opposition as to the prime minister's thinking and choice. If the leader concurs, that's the end of the Governor General Act. If the leader of the opposition doesn't concur, he goes back to the prime minister. And if the prime minister insists that he's going with what he had said initially, that's the end of that. And then the Governor General has a few discretionary areas in his staff, privy councillors, and such the like. The short point is this: the Governor General does not play any practical function in our system of government. He represents the British monarchy, a white colonial monarchy. However, the Governor General maintains critical formal functions. One critical formal function is this in the making of law. A bill shall not become law until the Governor General has assented thereto in Her Majesty's name and on Her Majesty's behalf and has signed it in token of such assent. So no law can be passed, presented to the Parliament without this acknowledgement that it is in the name of the Queen. Further, a bill shall not become law until the Governor General has assented thereto in Her Majesty's name and on Her Majesty's behalf and has signed it in token of such assent. So no law can be passed in Jamaica without this stamp of approval, without this stamp of legitimacy, without this stamp of validity. No law without the Governor General doing this in the Queen's name. Further, every single bill presented to the Parliament of this black country, every single bill presented to the Parliament of this black country has to have the following words: be it enacted by the Queen's Most Excellent Majesty, by and with the advice and consent of the Senate and House of Representatives of Jamaica, and by the authority of the same as follows. And then the text of the bill will then follow. Every single law in this black country must have this before it can become law. So the question that I am posing here today is, if the Governor General plays no practical function in the system of governance in the country, in policy formulation, in program formulation, but plays only a formal role in relation to laws being enacted and other aspects of our country, then it is obvious that the role is symbolic. What disturbs me most is that on independence, the then committee decided that we would entrench the office of the Queen. Now, this may sound very odd to persons who, you know, would think that you're becoming independent. Why would you specially entrench the office of the Queen if you are becoming independent? Well, the leaders at the time took a decision. They said that they were not only going to entrench the Queen, but they were going to specially entrench the Queen. That means we cannot get rid of the Queen unless we have a referendum in the country. The position of Queen in the country has more protection in the Constitution than the Charter of Rights for Jamaicans. That is so bizarre. The Queen and that seat of white supremacy has more protection in the Jamaican Constitution than the Charter of Rights given to Jamaicans. So you say, but why would they do that? Well, it is obvious, as Professor Hutton said earlier, that they did a good job on us. Our minds have been so enslaved that at the time the commission said that, hey, we don't need to go republic. Republican status is inconsistent, as it were, with what we are doing. We don't need to go republic, and we don't need to get rid of the Queen either, because our independence is consistent with having the Queen as the head of our state. And they then entrenched her. So You need 8 months of deliberations in the parliament between the introduction of the bill to when it is voted on, 8 months. And both houses have to agree 2/3 of majority of both houses sitting separately. And then we have to put it to the Jamaican people to vote on. We have a choice. We can continue to have King's House that plays no function in the country. First formed and built in 1762 in Spanish Town. Then when we moved to Kingston, 1872, where it's at now, they built that. We can continue to defer intellectual processes and legitimacy to the Queen. As I said earlier, no law can be passed in the country unless you have the stamp of the broad seal. No law can pass in the country unless you have that enactment that says it's done in the Queen's name. None at all. Nobody can act as Prime Minister unless the Governor General broad stamps it, appoints and broad stamps it. We have a choice. I'm an independent black man in this country, and I've made up my mind. I am not going to be part of this white supremacy King's House business at all. Its only function in the country is just to represent the Queen. No other function. So my suggestion is this. We need to topple that symbol of white supremacy in the country. You have choices. We could tear it down brick by brick, or we could make it into a museum for the enslavers. That's my take on King's House. Convert it into a museum where we put all the symbols of white supremacy, all the statues of Columbus, right across the country. Pack them up in King's House, and let's call it what it is. It's a museum of the enslavers. Some would say, let's tear it brick by brick. Well, you know, that's another matter. But we certainly should make it into a museum. And this independence will come and catch us, still with the Governor General, still a charge on the public purse, still representing white supremacy in the King's House. Are we going to cause Independence 60 to come without us ending white supremacy rule in Jamaica? No practical function in policy formulation, no practical function in programs for the country, no practical function in terms of the legislature and the executive, but the formal functions that the Governor General's office plays are very significant formal functions. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to move forward. So those who want to tear it down brick by brick, probably you could consider leaving it, putting all the enslavers' artifacts over there in King's House and title it for what it is, a museum of the enslavers. Thank you very much.
Wow. Thank you very, very much, Clyde. I mean, there are ways in which we have to seriously consider what you have proposed. Constitutional fictions, tokenism.
That is what it is.
The Charter of Rights, privileging the Queen and our emissaries. That's pretty much what we're faced with. Well, be it resolved, we are ready to remove the constitutional fictions enshrined in the Governor General of Jamaica. We demand constitutional reform. And I agree, Clyde, that we need to convert King's House into a museum for the Jamaican people. But
not
I don't
for the
agree.
Jamaican people, for the enslaved.
No. Well, I'm slightly only disagree. A museum for the Jamaican people makes more sense to me than building another edifice to the enslavers. We need a different sort of museum.
I know that you don't mean it like that.
But
let me just clarify before you call the next speaker. What I mean is that rather than tearing it down, which would be my choice, tear it brick for brick down, but that's all right. Let's convert it into a museum, but it's a museum that will only have the symbols of slavery in it. So the Jamaicans, when they go there, will know this museum represents the symbols associated with the rape of our forefathers. That's
all right. Absolutely. Thank you very, very much, Clyde. I think those comments have been very important for us to consider. They are things that are on the table. We've been talking about constitutional reform for some time. The time is now. In fact, the time is last year and 20 years and 40 years ago. Now, let me move to our last speaker, last but certainly not least, Professor Wayne Modest. Wayne is director of the Research Center of Material Culture, Critical Heritage Studies at a university's name that I cannot pronounce. So he's going to pronounce that for us. It looks like it's Vrije Universiteit. I'm not so sure. I could be cursing bad words as far as I know. But I want to say that Professor Modest is in the Faculty of Humanities. He was previously head of the curatorial department at the Troppen Museum, Amsterdam, and keeper of anthropology at the Horniman Museum in London, as well as director of the Museums of History and Ethnography in Kingston, Jamaica. He has held visiting scholar positions at various universities, and his research interests include histories of ethnographic collecting and display, questions of materiality, memory and mobility, as well as contested heritage. More recently, he has been working on questions surrounding material culture, repair, and historical injustice. So he's well placed to speak to us today on the whole idea. Everyone is crying out for peace. None is crying out for justice. Over to you, Wayne.
Thank you, Sonia. And it's always hard to come at the end of such a long set of conversations. I have only a few things to say. My first thing that I want to say is that actually, in a way, I want to give honor to the speakers before me, because one of the things, now I'm speaking from Amsterdam, so I'm speaking from Europe. So I'm speaking in a way from the belly of the beast. And one of the things that you learn when you're here as a Black person, as a person of color, is that you learn that, or I have learned anyway, that there is a look that I grew up with. I grew up with the names of Professor Shepherd and Professor Hutton, of Nettleford, of Elsa Govaya. And that has a very, very big significance for how we understand ourselves as Black people in the world. Whenever I talk to young people here and young Black people in many parts of Europe, they are still struggling to try and see themselves in intellectual labor, in intellectual work, in revolutionary intellectual practices. And so I want to start out by honoring the artists and the intellectuals, and including radical intellectuals that emerge out of reggae and Rastafari as something that we've contributed, that we need to celebrate. And that's how I'll end as well. I want to end with a certain kind of hope. So first of all, thank you to those who spoke before. My reason for using Burning Spear, Peter Tosh as my starting point, was primarily because I've been thinking about Peter Tosh as in very theoretical terms. I've been thinking about Peter Tosh's work as what I would call a theory of justice. That Peter Tosh provides us with a way to theorize what it means to be just. And it is not just justice, but it is redistributive justice. Everyone is crying out for peace. No one is crying out for justice. And why I start out with that is that one of the things that you notice when you're in Europe, when you're in the US and you see Black Lives Matter, or you see any kind of protest that happens in the streets, when Black people come up to revolt against the untenable, systematic precarity that they're placed in, people always cry out for peace. They say, don't talk so loud, don't fight so hard, don't use such violent words. What you need to do is let us do it. It's like what I call decolonization with a hug. You need to hug each other. There is never a discussion of whether or not the situation is unjust, or if it is a protracted injustice that we sit in. It is always a demand for peace. And so that is that revolutionary spirit that will attend to peace, but demand justice as well, is what you've been seeing and probably many of you have seen it in the toppling of monuments across the US, but also recently in England, in the UK, and as well, yeah, basically all over the world, but here in the Netherlands as well. So my talk this today is to try and think through a few of the things that always come up when we talk about changing monuments, changing street names, changing everything, all of those things. The first one I want to talk about is this question of move on. We love to talk about moving on. And I want to put one thing first out there. This is just, I'm just going to name them and give some comments to them. Moving on is about what I would call Western or white discovery. As soon as the white world discovers something, they seem to want to move on. So for example, we will talk about, Rastafari will go to the Queen and Rastafari will say something like, "We want reparations." And the Queen will say, "It was not a crime against humanity at the time." But whose time are we speaking about? For many of the enslaved, it was a crime against their humanity. But at one moment, we discover the term crime against humanity, or the West discovers that term, crime against humanity, and then we can mobilize that term. But prior to that, nothing prior to that can be invoked. It is the same thing that we say when you ask people about, they say, it was the law at the time. It was the law at the time. Whose law was it at the time? And one of the things that I've been thinking through, and Professor Shepherd, I want to call out to you for this. That's one of the very easy statements that people give when it comes to the restitution of objects from museums. They say it was collected when it was the law at the time. And I always said to them, but if the law turned Black people into property and then took their property, then you can't just say that it was the law. The law is conscripted in a racializing project that made it possible for us to take objects away from people. So there is a sense in which this notion of it was the law at the time, move on. Another one that we talk about all the time is, but we cannot rewrite history, we say. To take down monuments is a rewriting of history. It was moral at the time. All of these excuses are excuses that is a part of what I think about as a decolonization that does not destabilize whiteness. It does not destabilize the West. It is a decolonization that still sees whiteness as its starting point. And therefore, one cannot talk about the revolutionary potential or the revolutionary practices of the enslaved or in their desires not to sell or to give away objects, because we always go back to an idea that it was legal once Europe said it was legal. I saw one comment in the text just now as some of you were speaking, and the text, and they said, but is the university not colonial? And is the museum not colonial? And I want to first of all acknowledge that. In a certain way, the museum as a construct, how it is understood as a formation, is definitely a colonial formation, without question, that is so. But I want to also acknowledge that a part of the work of since the 1960s or before, since the 1930s as well, is that there have been a lot of people fighting to create other forms of imagining what a museum or a university can look like. So I don't think that we should give in to this idea that the museum is a colonial thing or that the university is a colonial thing, that therefore we need to get rid of it. Because if we were to do that, we would not acknowledge the importance, for example, of what the Edmund College has been able to do. I'm not talking about necessarily the name, but what I'm saying is that it has been able to create a particular kind of arts infrastructure in the Caribbean that has been important to foreground a certain kind of radical art practice that is necessary for us to imagine different kinds of futures. One could suggest that the Edna Mandy College still needs a lot of work to be done, similar to the university. I like how Sonia celebrates the university in a certain way, that there's much more work to be done for us to push forward a decolonial agenda. But at the same time, one has to acknowledge the work that arts and artists and art institutions have been doing to try and imagine what a museological idea could look like from the perspective of Blackness, from the perspective of the Caribbean, and give credit to that kind of perspective. Now, I want to move to disagree a little bit with Professor Hutton, if I may, by suggesting that monuments can always be destroyed. Destroying monuments is a part of a project of the creation of a monument is something that you decide as a society. You decide in a heritage sector that monuments should be kept or whatever. Monuments can also be destroyed. Many people say to me, but nobody even notices the Victoria Monument anymore. It doesn't do anything because nobody sees it anymore. And my response has been more recently, we don't see whiteness anymore. White supremacy is so silent sometimes that what white supremacy does is that you don't hear about it. You just use the name of the Governor General and you don't even think of what it is. Monuments are like that. They are silent part of how whiteness continues to operate, to structure a sense of our own selves. So to say that monuments don't need to be destroyed is to suggest perhaps that one might continue a certain way in which whiteness continues to be quiet. And one should try to undo some of that. And it is not to say, I'm not suggesting that we tear down all of them. I would never say that. I'm a heritage man. That's what I do. I love it. I love objects. So I even have a stomach pain when I say this just right now. However, I think that it is part and parcel of an independent society to think that it can move some monuments into a park of death, of shame, into a museum of the enslaved, or it can destroy them. It is part and parcel of a society that you can also organize every year a National Day of Shame when you all just throw red paint on one monument. Everybody does that as a symbolic act. That is a part and parcel of how an independent nation understands itself and mobilizes monuments to be able to be part of that self-care and self-love. Because one of the things that I know while in Europe, and this is a very, very difficult thing when it comes to monuments and the relationship to citizenship. Let me take, for example, Britain. I'm not going to take the Netherlands, but let me take Britain. And if you think about me living in Britain today as a British citizen, let us call it that. I'm a British citizen, and I'm as much a citizen as the other citizen who is white in Britain. And every day that white person pass by the monument, they look at a monument and they say, wow, I should be proud of my country. And every day I'm supposed to walk past that same monument and I must say, wow, that person enslaved my ancestors. That is not just citizenship. A just citizenship practice shouldn't mean that I walk through the landscape of the urban and continually feel shame because I was colonized, whereas my fellow citizen can continually feel pride because they colonized my forefathers. Just citizenship means that we should walk through the landscape with a similar kind of just distribution of pride about what it means to be a nation. It is within that framework that I would like to suggest that when we have spaces in Jamaica that still in some ways, some of the great houses, for example, that still in some ways want to celebrate a genealogy of celebrating historical violence, that is not a place that is for a nation that wants to distribute good feelings, pride equally. It is a space that continues to denigrate some in favor of a history for some who are never there at all. But I want to kind of close off with even something more difficult. Because I have come to believe more and more, and I want to ask you this. Why do we need the monumental practice as the way in which we celebrate? Why is it that that is the modality through which we want to celebrate our heroes? Is it necessary that monuments are the way in which we celebrate heroes? Is it necessary that the way we understand heritage, because I've come to question whether or not UNESCO isn't colonial. I've come to question whether or not the UN isn't a part of an ongoing colonial. I've come to question whether or not the International Council of Museums that we ascribe to isn't a part of an ongoing colonial. Because what we do when we go to all, whether or not the International Court of Justice isn't a part of an ongoing colonial. I say it as a joke, but we must admit that the International Court of Justice is not in Jamaica. It is in the Netherlands. That the ICOM is in France. And we must admit that almost every single standards that we try to implement in our museums today are standards that are created and mobilized and sustained in France and in Europe. So what we do is that we get development money, and the development money sends us an expert to come from France, and the expert comes to Jamaica, and the expert says to us that you need to keep the objects at 55% relative humidity, 45 to 55, and you need to keep them at 17 to 19 degrees Celsius. Now you tell me, in a country where the temperature is always near 30 degrees, aren't objects just get sick, get cold, when it has to go down to 17 degrees? In a country when you wake up in the morning, the relative humidity is already 75%. Why do we need to bring objects down to 55% relative humidity? The reason for that is that we are conscripted in a global heritage structure, a global United Nations structure that continues to articulate its narrative from a center, which is Europe. One must ask oneself the question, is that itself emancipation or independence? But it is not to suggest that these structures are not important. Actually, what I'm more suggesting, and this is where I'm going to go a little bit out of my territory and probably name names that I shouldn't name, but it is more to suggest that there was a radical moment, I think, if I can remember well, I can't remember that well, in the 1960s, early 70s, when there was a language of a non-aligned movement that was trying to reorder how we understood the center of power in the world. It was trying to reorder how we understood what the political could look like, where the underdeveloped were trying to lead in the thinking about what decolonization could mean. My challenge is two things. On the one hand, well, let me start out. How can we lead again, or at least contribute more robustly to an international rethinking of what heritage might look like that helps to emancipate not only us from this heritage regime that takes cultural heritage in a particular way that is defined through all of these structures. I see everybody talk about ICOM all the time when you work in museums. How can we emancipate ourselves from those global structures? I am cautious right now because the International Council of Museums just tried to redo its definition. And one of its redoing of its definition was to include questions of colonial histories, democratization, a certain push towards social justice. And that definition was boycotted by much of Europe because they felt that it was going to push away the center of power from Europe's definition of what museums should be. We need to think again about that structure. But I want to end by suggesting something even more probably a little bit more difficult. Because for me, perhaps to start out with, for me anyway, with Peter Tosh, I want to end by thinking about what Sizzler says when Sizzler starts out by saying, they want to use our face on tourist board, but they really don't like Rastaman. I want to go back to, and I know this might be controversial, but I'm going back to him anyway, to Vybz Kartel, who says, let us think reparation, scam differently and call it what it is. It is reparations. And I know people might be concerned about who Vybz Kartel is or not, but fundamentally, that is a philosophical argument that he's making. A similar argument he's making to Charles Mills makes in his book, The Racial Contract, by suggesting that one has to already acknowledge that philosophy, like museology, like heritage, like monumentalization, their starting point was in our epistemic formation that centralized whiteness, and at the same time suggested that Black people were not human. And what we need to try and do is to try and reshift that. But I will also say that is what Jamaica, I think anyway, and the professors who are here now and the doctors have been doing, but also people like Bernie Spear, like Peter Tosh, like Bob Marley, like Vybz Kartel. They've been trying to reorganize our ideas of what knowledge is, to centralize the poor, to centralize the urban poor, to centralize Blackness, and to try and reorganize the world by suggesting that it is only scamming when you take from the wealthy white Europe. That's how Europe understands itself. When they take the object, it is legal. When we take the object, it is scamming. What Vybz Kartel suggests is actually that it might be reparations. I close with saying that a part of the project of rethinking the monument is a project of rethinking how we can repair historical injustices. And a part of that might require that we destroy some of those monuments. It is just what it is. Because if they continue to stay there, it can be, it is, silent white supremacy. That's what I have to say.
Wow. I want to thank you for those comments, those reflections, Wayne. Really and truly, I hear us returning very swiftly as a matter of necessity to Sylvia Winter's humanism in the ways in which we have to decolonize philosophies and even the ontologies that centralize white supremacy. And, you know, I'm taking note of the questions in our chat. How can our centers be in Europe? How can we decolonize ourselves from these global structures was your take on the question in your own presentation, Wayne. And those are not questions that we're going to resolve today, but we certainly can make some giant steps. And some of the ways in which we have to make those steps have to do with how we reorient our minds, how we rethink what it is we are even calling scamming, what we are even calling reparations. Can it only be a certain form? We need to revolutionize the way in which we're considering these terms. So thank you so much for that. I don't see any burning questions. So I'm going to ask each of you speakers, going in the order we presented, or certainly any of you feeling a burning issue. Wayne, can you just tilt your computer so we can see your face? We only saw half of your head.
It's 1 a.m. here, so I'm a little sleepy.
You're drooping like the screen. I want to ask each of you to just give us your closing remarks. Wrap up for us. Tell us, where do we go from here? What reflections do you want to leave with us? Closing remarks from each of you. Thank you.
Well, I'll jump in since nobody wants to start. May I start?
Please go ahead.
Just that we have 2 years within which, you know, we're going to be 60 in 2 years. And I think we need to start this big push to get rid of the last major monument of white supremacy in the country. So I'm part of that project, and I'm just a little bit short of taking the knee on the anthem. I must tell you, I'm very close to taking the knee on the anthem. I've already discarded the motto because it really is out of many Black people suffering. The out of many, we are one, it's an illusion. And it has caused many persons to bind to the illusion without struggling to ensure there's economic equality across the country. Let's get rid of King's House by 60 years old. Thank you.
And so say all of us. Closing remarks, reflections. Where do we go from here?
Good. I think we have all been muted and we have a central controller of the button. So I've just been letting. I want it, first of all, to thank you, the organizers, this amazing conversation, and I hope the series will continue. I also want to thank my fellow panelists, because I think that each of us put another brick on this building. It's a pyramid towards decolonial justice, and I hope we'll reach the peak at some point. I'm also very proud of those I taught at the University of the West. Somebody actually sent me a message to say, I know you taught Shani and Wayne. Influence on them. So kudos to you. But on another note, I really want to end by saying, what we know, what we have been able to share, has been made possible because we have an introduction to revisionists. We are talking to a generation who does not have that privilege. We have to become scholar activists or grassroots activists of whatever location, from whatever location we occupy, to call on those who have the power or take the power in some way to ensure civics education, the philosophies and opinions of Marcus Mosiah Garvey, history, Caribbean revisionist history education, be on the syllabus for everyone. I believe it's a crime against humanity to deny any generation an understanding of their origins, their history, and their identity. To do so is to make us all into colonial zombies, walking about the place without any connection. We have to ensure that when we talk about moving monuments, moving statues, reshaping museums, I hope everyone understands the rationale. And a lot of the rationale lies within a kind of decolonial education. So let us push for that so that we can gather. We want to gather soldiers in your army.
Thank you very much, Vireen. You know I'm already in that army. Closing remarks. Clinton? Clinton. You're there now.
Okay, a number of things. What is clear is that we have to be more forceful in two things. Well, three things. In creating materials broadly, in drama, in the novel, visual arts, dance, music, the written and spoken words, and to develop, to marry that with pedagogy. At all levels of our educational institution, formal and informal. At the community level, we need more community activism in culture of liberation, ideas of liberation, in the histories of those communities, who were the key players. Colonialism never existed without anti-colonialism. It's always been that. There's always been a political, a philosophical, and cultural struggles against colonialism. That didn't begin yesterday. It's from a long time ago. And prior to colonialism, there is a history of Africa, pre-colonial Africa. So that the educational institutions at the level of policy, but community organizations, youth clubs, the church, citizens association, the call to have history taught formally and informally, I think it's very important in order to develop the type of consciousness that is requisite for our journey to become. So I point to that. Secondly, is that there are a lot of colonial documents that we don't have access to. MI6, for example, has millions of documents. The British authorities have seen it fit to allow those documents to be kept by MI6. Not in any ordinary museum. No, it's important for us to get those documents. It's important for us to see them, to understand what is in those documents. Those are colonial documents, but they're important. You wouldn't want them to be destroyed. If the British should try to destroy those documents now, right? I am sure you would want them to be destroyed. You want to know what are the things that are in those documents. For this same reason, in relation to monuments, they are important Caribbean monuments. There are monuments and philosophies of monuments that are different from the European aesthetic tradition and monuments tradition. We need to understand that. And monuments existed long before there was a Europe. Right? Not only that, monuments have always been attached to the notion of power, of certitude. And that is the light in which I see monuments. Monuments, certainly monuments that are around, I don't wish to see them where they are. But they nonetheless should remain teaching materials. Mm-hmm. We should not suffer. Let our generation suffer. They need to make the connection, just as they need to make that connection with their forebears. We see monuments on the outside, and you ask many students, for example, and I do it all the time, how many of you have ever been to a Naya Bingi? Almost zero. How many of you have ever been to a revival table? Or whatever in that tradition, or about some dance developed by our forebears and pageantry developed by them. We seek to marginalize them, to make them invisible, when they should be the center of what we do. For example, there are sites and the culture of imagination from a certain period that can be very useful to us now, right? So while we need to free them up, But we also need to do the research of interpretation. And the interpretations, there are meanings attached to them by our forebearers. And believe me, those meanings are still around. Right? So
indeed.
So some of those monuments, there's, you go to Guyana, you see Queen Victoria, go to certain places, you see this and that. I don't wish to be where they are. You go to Barbados, you see another set. Jamaica, you see another set. There should be a special place for them. But there's also the Caribbean monument. You go to Santiago de Cuba and you see the monument to Antonio Maceo. It's not no little dibby-dibby monument. Monuments must have impact. Sites must have impact. Impact for you to contemplate, for you to sit and to feel. Right? We don't do a good. You have, in Georgetown, you have the monument to the uprising of 1753. So they are very impressive monuments coming from us. But sometimes we tend to do monuments as if they are jokes while retaining the colonial monuments.
Thank you very much, Clinton. Closing remarks, Wayne?
Yeah, I mean, I should say thank you. I mean, and thanks for to be able to listen as well to Clinton and to Chani and to everybody. I just want to, I've been thinking recently, and this probably comes even as contradictory to what I've just said, but I've been thinking recently about the fact that across all of the Caribbean, there's something about the arts and heritage infrastructure that has been developed in Jamaica. And that infrastructure, I think, is on the one hand is deeply problematic. There is a lot about it that still reeks with the colonial. And on the other hand, I think we also have to think more critically, or even think, I don't know if it's pride is the word, because I don't like that word, about that infrastructure that we've had, that I could have grown up to, as Professor Shepherd said, to be taught Caribbean histories through her, but I could have grown up to read the Caribbean literature. But also that you have an arts infrastructure where other people come, because we've had that since the 20th century. There is this arts infrastructure that has made it so that Jamaica can be a part of a global practice of not just replicating structures of art practice, but having a voice out there. Young people who have been taught by people like at the art school by Petrona and Ra and so, who are now global artists, making us a statement in the world, also about what it means to be Black in this world. So in a way, what I'm trying to say cautiously at the end, from my end anyway, is that I want to hold on to another kind of radical hope that we have also an infrastructure in place that we can mobilize to be able to imagine different kind of futures. And that infrastructure was jointly made by some of the people here, but also is being continued by yourself and Jelani and so forth. Because being ensconced in Europe, I miss that. I miss that infrastructure. I miss that kind of space where we know that one is still battling with a colonial history, but we're still trying to push forward a narrative for what it means to be Black, Jamaican, whatever in the world. And I think that we need to even celebrate that as an important thing, even while we decolonize, because the decolonization process has been going on for a while now. So we need to also acknowledge that. And my last point was that I like the fact that you mentioned Sylvia Winter, primarily because, and this is what I mean by move on, Sylvia Winter, like Fanon, I think, were asking us to think humanism differently away from whiteness. Whereas somebody like Sartre was, and the West was thinking we should get rid of humanism. So that is where the struggle always in. Europe always wants us to move on, but we have our work to do. And I think that we have the infrastructure to be able to do that work. So the question is, how do we fund it, support it, celebrate it, push it, so that it can create an agenda for a more equitable and just world. That's all I want to end.
Thank you very much, Wayne. Closing remarks, Dr. Ropo?
So I just want to thank everyone. Well, I want to thank you for the invitation to participate. I think I was taught by Prof, but Wayne is actually my first boss. So we work together at the Institute of Jamaica. And one of the things I have found in kind of thinking through how we teach history and identity and how we operate in a museum space is one of the things that I find is missing. The voices that are missing are voices of Jamaicans who are not radical and are not a part of that romanticized Jamaican peasant experience. And one of the things that I think a lot of Jamaicans don't see is that they don't see themselves as movers and shakers because they're not the charismatic personalities. They don't see themselves as making a dot on the landscape of what is Jamaicanness. And I think that as we are fighting for the reinstitutionalization of history, and as the Global South is fighting for a different approach to museums, that we actually have to find ways in non-traditional sites to have students or have people see themselves as their presence is a dot on the landscape of Jamaicanness and change. And so I think that as we go on to dismantle legacies of colonialism and rethink our institutions, that as long as we have all Jamaicans finding some way to be owners of the space and seeing themselves as having an impact on society, that we may at some point advance, hopefully in the next 2 years, but I suspect it will take another 50 to kind of move forward as a nation. But I want to thank you all for this opportunity. I really have, it's been just really just engaging and important for the discussions we have to have today.
Thank you very much, Shani. And I want to begin, or let me say, end where I began. I began with thanks, and I want to end with those thanks again. Thanks to you, the audience, for joining us. Thanks to our able speakers, our production team. Especially want to thank Isabel Dennis, Cadian Williams, Bettine Ross Laws, and of course our coordinator for this event, Dr. Jelani Nair, who is lecturer in the Institute of Caribbean Studies, but also member of the National Council for Reparations. We are the Institute of Caribbean Studies in the Faculty of Humanities and Education. We offer programs in cultural studies, cultural and creative industries, entertainment and cultural enterprise management, and music and performance studies. Join us again for another in this summer series as we simultaneously offer our summer courses. Some of you have asked questions about the courses we are offering this summer. Check us out online, follow us on our various social media platforms. I'm really pleased. This is one of the very first events that we have live streamed on our Facebook page. So we hope to catch you again. Thank you all very, very much, and walk good.